Dividing things evenly is something that you probably do every once in a while, like cutting up a cake, for instance. When the cake is circular, it is well understood that you just have to cut the cake into equal sectors, and you can do it for however many people you are serving and still serve the whole cake. But what if the cake is square? The analog to a sector in this case is just a triangle, so can you still serve the entire cake evenly to n people in triangular pieces? To be a bit more mathematically direct about the problem, given a square, for which n can you divide the square into n equal area triangles? This might not seem like an interesting question, but it links together a lot of different types of math, and even though it sounds like a geometry problem from the ancient Greeks, it wasn't posed until 1965 and it wasn't answered until 1970. We're going to spend the entire video answering this question, so if you want to try and address it on your own, but don't know where to start, I'm going to recommend thinking about the case of n being even first, and then think about the case where n is 3. We're also going to start with some combinatorics and graph theory, so it might help to think about those areas too. Okay, so if you're taking some time and still can't figure it out, or if you just want to know what the answer is, we'll get there, but we're going to have to start with something called Sperner's lemma. In the two-dimensional case, it states that for every three-colored triangulation of a square, the number of three-colored triangles is equivalent modulo 2 to the number of two-colored edges of a certain type on the perimeter. So, what does that mean? Well, first off, a triangulation of a square is a graph like this one, where every region is a triangle, and a three-colored triangulation is just one where the vertices have exactly three different colors. Let's say red, yellow, and green. Now there are three different types of two-colored edges that may occur: yellow-red, red-green, and green-yellow. For the rest of the video, our chosen type is red-green. Now, the module 2 part of the lemma says that if the number of red-green edges on the perimeter is odd, then the number of three-colored triangles in the triangulation is also odd. And if the number of red-green edges on the perimeter is even, then the number of three-colored triangles in the triangulation is also even. For this diagram here, we can quickly see that this is the case. So, how do you exactly prove it? Well, we're going to use some combinatorics. On each side of a red-green edge, put a dot. If the red-green edge is on the perimeter, only put one dot, because we only care about dots being on the interior of the square. Now, using triangles, we can go ahead and count the number of dots. To do this, if we look at a three-colored triangle, there is only one dot, as there is only one red-green edge, and in all other triangles, there are either zero or two dots. So since we're counting modulo 2, the number of dots is the number of three-colored triangles modulo 2. Now, using edges, we count again. On a red-green edge, we have one dot if it is on the perimeter, but then for all other edges in the triangulation, we have either 0 or 2 dots. So modulo 2, the number of dots is just the number of red-green colored edges on the perimeter. Thus, the number of 3 colored triangles and the number of red-green colored edges is equal modulo 2, and we have proven the lemma. So that's great, but we're going to need another tool. Specifically, we need a different way of talking about the size of a number. Oftentimes, we use the absolute value to get the size of a number. The absolute value is an example of a norm, which means it is a function that has the following properties. Another family of norms are the p-adic norms. So here's a definition. Given a rational number x and a prime number p, we can write x as a product of a rational number and a power of that prime p to the k. And this is unique by the unique prime factorization of the numerator and denominator of our rational number x. Then the p-adic norm is given by the inverse of p to the kth power. We're concerned specifically with the 2-adic norm. So for instance, the 2-adic norm of 2/125 is 1/2, just as the 2-adic norm of 2 is 1/2, and the 2-adic norm of 1250 is just the 2-adic norm of 2 times 5 to the 4th, because that's the prime factorization of 1250, and so that is also 1/2. So, things that would be different sizes in terms of absolute value are actually the same size in terms of the 2-adic norm. Now, we need to extend the norm to the real numbers. For a lot of irrationals, this is easy. We just force the third property of norms. So, the two-adic norm of 2 is the two-adic norm of the square root of 2 times the two-adic norm of the square root of 2, which is 1/2. And so we get that the two-adic norm of the square root of 2 is just the square root of 1/2. For transcendental numbers like pi and e, this is a bit harder, but the axiom of choice tells us that they exist, even though they are not necessarily computable. If that isn't satisfying enough, we can just say that the two-adic norms of pi and e are just 1. It won't affect the following proof that we will use to answer our question about cutting squares into equal area triangles. Alrighty, so we're ready to prove Monsky's theorem, which states that it is impossible to dissect a square into an odd number of triangles of equal area. It sounds counterintuitive and hard to prove, but Sperner's lemma and the two-adic norm are going to be really helpful, and hopefully we'll clear this up. The proof starts off by taking the unit square and breaking it up into n equal area triangles, which is just a triangulation. We're going to show that n must be even. So we're going to go ahead and define some colors for our triangulation based on the two-adic norm. A vertex is red if the two-adic norm of x and the two-adic norm of y are both strictly less than 1. A vertex is green if the two-adic norm of x is greater than 1 and the two-adic norm of y is less than or equal to the two-adic norm of x. And a vertex is yellow if the two-adic norm of y is greater than 1 and the two-adic norm of x is strictly less than the two-adic norm of y. We don't know what the interior of the triangulation looks like, but we do know that the corners of our square are vertices of the triangulation, and we can go ahead and color them according to our rules. So 0, 0 will be red, 1, 0 will be green, 0, 1 will be yellow, and 1, 1 will be yellow. Notice as well that the only colors that can occur on the segment from 0, 0 to 1, 0 are red and green, since the two-adic norm of the y-coordinate is always 0. We can make a similar statement about the other sides. So only the colors red and yellow can occur on the segment from 0, 0 to 0, 1, and only yellow and green can occur on the segments from 1, 0 to 1, 1, and 0, 1 to 1, 1. So our diagram might look like this on the perimeter. What's really nice here is that only an odd number of red-green edges can occur on the perimeter, no matter how you divide the edge from 0, 0 to 1, 0 with red and green vertices. You always have an odd number of red-green edges. If you're not sure of why this is true, you should definitely think about it for a bit before moving on. It is the crux of the proof, as it allows us to use Sperner's lemma, which tells us that the number of three-colored triangles is odd. Moving on, that means that there exists at least one three-colored triangle. Wherever one of them may be, we translate the entire diagram so that the red vertex in the triangle is at the origin. Since a red vertex has coordinates with norms less than 1, and the yellow and green coordinates have at least one coordinate with norms greater than 1, the translation does not change the coloring of the diagram. Here, I've provided the calculation that shows the green vertex will still be green after translation. I'll leave the translation of the yellow vertex up to you as an exercise. So if you want to take a second and think about that, the argument is very similar. After translation, we have this new diagram, where our three-colored triangle has its red vertex at the origin. Using some coordinate geometry, we can calculate the area, which gives us the following equality. However, notice that n times this area is 1, so taking the two-adic norm of the quantity of the area times n should also give us 1. Using our properties of the two-adic norm, we get this expression, and by definition of our colors, we have that the two-adic norm of the area is greater than 1. But that just means that the two-adic norm of n is strictly less than 1, which means that n has a factor of 2, and that means that the number of triangles has to be even and thus cannot be odd. This answers our initial question, and this is a really cool problem in proof because it links together a ton of different math, like number theory, combinatorics, graph theory, and geometry all into one little tiny bundle. Anyhow, I could nerd out more about how cool this intersection of mathematics is, but I should go ahead and stop here and leave you with some questions. Since we can't have an odd number of equal area triangles, can the difference in these areas be minimized in some way? And what about other polygons? Can you break, per se, a regular pentagon into quadrilaterals of equal area? Those are just some things that I'm thinking about right now, but Anyhow, that is all I have for you today. If you enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe for more mathematics videos. As always, I am Nathan, this is Chuck, and I will see you next time.